For most of the history of photography, we have shot photographs in black and white. So when we see these photographs in color, it feels as if someone brought them to life. They don't appear so old anymore. Today I'm going to color one such image, quite a recent one actually, and I'm going to tell you the story around it. The story of India-Pakistan War of 1971. But first a little disclaimer. Okay, that was not little. This is Field Marshal SFHJ Manekshaw. Mind you, Field Marshal is not a rank that is simply attainable by climbing the promotional ladder in Indian Army. I'll get to the story really soon, but let us first begin with colorization. Now this photograph is really small, resolution-wise. So what I'll first do is upscale this. For that, I found a really amazing online tool called Vans AI. It is subscription-based, but they do offer free trials. Look at this amazing upscale though. Well, I'll just download the image, load it in Adobe Photoshop and get rid of the watermark. Then I'll convert this image into black and white first, because many old shots do contain a tint of some other color, usually sepia. After this, I'll convert this back into 8-bit RGB. Now I'll have to remove all the dust and freckles and other artifacts out. I'll simply use clone tool. You can also use various heal brushes and patch replacement tools. Well, in clone tool you just sample a clean area by holding S and clicking, and then pasting the sample over whatever you want to remove. While I do this for other spots. The year is 1970. In the Indian subcontinent, the tensions are on rise. Pay closer attention to the country of Pakistan. Can you notice something weird? Here you had West Pakistan, which had the capital, 47% of population which spoke Punjabi, Urdu, Sindhi and Pashto mainly, and about 71% of national budget spending. Now this was East Pakistan. It had 53% of total population, yet only 29% of national budget spending. They spoke Bengali mainly, and had a recently devastating cyclone which was horribly mismanaged. You know where this is going. In 1970, elections were held in which Awami League, a political party of East Pakistani origin, led by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, won a clear victory, winning 160 seats out of 300 in National Assembly, leaving other major party from West, Pakistan People's Party, led by Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, in dust with just 81 seats. This did not go down well with ruling elites of West Pakistan. Many leaders, including some in military, had pretty racist views towards people of Bengal. The convening of assembly was delayed by President Yahya Khan, and this did not go down well with Bengalis this time. They had nothing in common with West except religion, and tensions were always there. But this was the final straw. On 7th March 1971, Mujibur Rahman called for independence.
Ebare Sangram, amader mukti sangram. Ebare Sangram, swadheshatar sangram.
And Yahya Khan imposed martial law. Then Pakistani military cracked down hard on East Pakistan. And boy oh boy, hard doesn't even come close to describe what actually happened. Now the image is dust and spot free, so I'll begin with actual colorization. Let's begin with the background, the grass, sky and background. Coloring the sky is easy, I'll just select the general area out using lasso tool, and then to fine tune the selection, I'll go to select, color range and select highlight in pop-up. Now adjust the slider and you'll get your perfect selection. To actually apply color, I'll use the easiest tool in my bag. Press Ctrl B to open color balance menu and adjust it so that sky looks blue. For additional settings like hue, saturation and luminance, press Ctrl U and go on adjust the sliders. For grass, I'll go with a bit more sophistication. Let me select this patch here. Now I'll add a gradient map to it. What a gradient map does is it maps the tone of this bar right here to the exposure levels of selected area. So darker areas get this color and brighter areas get this. Oh, don't forget to change the layer mode to color. To add additional touch of reality, double click the map layer and in the style menu, adjust these sliders. What they do is they tell the layer, if the exposure is between this range, apply this layer. Since human eyes and cameras are not very good with colors, if things are too bright or too dark, doing this adds a bit of reality to the colorization. I'll repeat this for rest of grass and ground object. So after working in 8 times fast forward, now our background is complete. Now what we want is these uniforms in color. For that I'll use a source image. I'll color correct it until I think it matches the conditions in our subject image. Now I'll begin picking the colors out and apply it wherever needed. No questions asked. The brush must be in color mode, by the way. I'll also color the straps and guns out, and after working in 8 times fast forward yet again, all we are left with is the uniform of Manekshaw and skin tones. But first, back to the story. From late March to beginning of December, what happened in East was, for lack of a better term, genocide. The operation was initially aimed at arresting political leaders, intellectuals, and students. The Bangla units of army were either transferred or neutralized by seizing weapons, and all international communications were cut down. Military expected all resistance to die before 10th April. There was fierce resistance, and many Bengali military officers were either executed or imprisoned. By June, most of the country was under Pakistani control. Mujibur Rahman was captured and flown to the West. Political leaders who could flee the nation did so, and along with them began a downpour of refugees to India, around 10 million of which were accepted in various refugee camps across the border. The resistant forces that remained, along with Bengali defects from Pakistani army, now created a united new independence force, known as Mukti Bahini. To oppose that, Pakistani military and their supporters, mostly pro-Islamic parties, raised a paramilitary force of collaborators called Razakars. Hindu populations were targeted primarily, and prominent Hindu sites like Jagannath Hall of Dhaka University campus and Ramnakali Temple were sites of massacres and subject to destruction.
Shows Pakistani soldiers executing students, professors, and workers at the University of Dhaka last March 26. The first sequence shows Pakistani soldiers forcing students to carry and pile up the bodies of victims already killed.
Even non-Bengali Muslims were being targeted by Bengali troops as retaliation, most of whom were Urdu-speaking Biharis. Children did not escape the horror. The lucky ones were killed with their parents. The details are actually so graphic that I cannot put them here, but in those 8 or 9 months, it is estimated that about 200,000 to 3 million people were killed. From 1,000 to 150,000 Urdu-speaking Biharis were killed, and from 200,000 to 400,000 Bengali women were subjected to rapes. Rest of the world didn't even know what was going on, until Pakistan sent a team of 8 journalists to write a story that would paint them in good light. 7 of them did as they were told, but one of them, Anthony Mascarenhas, escaped Pakistan for UK and wrote an article for Sunday Times, titled Genocide. This was the moment the world realized the scale of what was going. And this was the article that led Indian Prime Minister Indira Gandhi to prepare the ground for India's armed intervention. In India, well, Prime Minister concluded it was much more cheaper to go to a full-scale war rather than accepting millions of impoverished refugees. Soon, the refugee camps became the site of guerrilla warfare training, and India began preparing for the war itself, under its Chief of Army Staff, SFHJ Manekshaw. Talking about him, for the uniform of general, I'll use this image as source. And again, I'll color correct it to what I think is the best and begin coloring. First, the arm badge of army headquarters, again with a source. Then I'll color rest of the uniform. Mind you, I'm not going for 100% accuracy, even though I should. Then there are colors in ribbon, which again, not 100% accurate because they are not even clearly visible. Then collar length and finally shoulder. Now I'll fine-tune the colors and only skin remains. For skin, I'll again go with gradient maps, like in the grass. I'll pick the skin tones for different brightness levels from this image again. Then I'll just apply it. Not very realistic, is it? Well, change the mode first to color. Still looks a bit dead. To bring a bit of life, I'll create a hue saturation layer and apply a bit of red to cheeks and lips. I'll apply a bit of green to other regions that are a bit greener, usually where facial hair grows. Finally, I'll use that blending option feature again, and this looks okay, not very good, but I won't complain. Now I'll color rest of the faces, but I'll not bore you with repetition. Instead, the war is about to begin. West Pakistan knew a war with India was inevitable. From April to 2nd December, India was gearing up, moving huge amount of troops to the border. From Indian perspective, the goal was to capture Dhaka, the capital of Eastern Wing. Prime Minister Indira Gandhi and her government asked Sam Manekshaw to move into East Pakistan. Sam simply refused, arguing that monsoon is about to arrive and Indian troops and armor would be bogged down in mud and swollen rivers. Besides, the army wasn't ready. Instead, attack was planned in winter, when lands would be drier and China wouldn't be able to intervene through ground. Gandhi spent this time traveling various countries for support and finally signed a treaty with Soviet Union, which would come really handy further down the war. Well, on 3rd December 1971, Pakistan launched surprise preemptive strikes on Indian airfields. Pakistan's battle plan was something like this. F*** this, we are probably going to lose eastern Pakistan, but we must grab whatever we can on the western border so we can negotiate better. With this airstrike, India finally declared the war. Pakistan launched several ground offensives, but India held the ground firmly. One such glorious battle from Indian perspective is Longewala, where on 4th of December, 120 Indian soldiers defended an outpost against 2,000 Pakistani soldiers, supported by 40 tanks. In the east, Mukti Bahini was growing increasingly active as months passed by from June to December, and Colonel MAG Osmani was appointed as Commander-in-Chief. They led attacks on border outposts set up by Pakistan and captured 90 out of 370 POPs. So, Pakistan sent another 5 battalions from west to east. India still heavily outnumbered Pakistan, especially with support from Mukti Bahini. In a single week, India dominated the skies and blockaded the east with its navy.
The Indian army is in Bangladesh. Your air force has been destroyed. You are surrounded on all sides. And if you don't surrender, you will be killed.
United States clearly supported Pakistan. US requested / forced its Mid-Eastern allies to help the losing country via military aid and send its aircraft carrier USS Enterprise to Indian Ocean to threaten India. To counter this, USSR sent 2 groups of ships armed with nuclear missiles, honoring the agreement they signed earlier. USSR also vetoed 2 immediate ceasefire resolutions in UN Security Council, and this cemented their friendship with India for a long time to come. On field, Pakistani army fought bravely wherever they could. Often Indian forces would just bypass them, following a quick blitzkrieg-like strategy. Indian forces captured Dhaka on 16th, just 14 days after the war started, and Pakistani commander of Eastern Command, Lieutenant General A.A.K. Niazi, surrendered its entire 4-tier army on 16th to Lieutenant General Jagjit Singh Arora. The new nation of Bengal, Bangladesh, finally became a reality. India captured 93,000 prisoners of war and treated them with complete respect to Geneva Convention. General Manekshaw used to frequently visit prisoner of war camps. Prisoners of war were given copies of Quran, and Manekshaw tasted the food himself that was being prepared for them. Manekshaw faced quite a bit of backlash from some political figures, but he didn't care. On 2nd of July next year, a peace treaty was signed, putting an end to the war. India didn't follow up its gains and just aimed for status quo, which was and is seen by many, including Sam Manekshaw, as a huge mistake. Though a new nation of Bangladesh was now indeed a reality, prisoners of war would soon be flown back to home. Now, well, I'm done. The War of 1971 was and is seen as a clear failure of Jinnah's two-nation theory, who thought religion would be a clear decisive force to keep a nation united. And yet, here lie two pieces of a nation-state, one shocked and reeling from the loss, and one celebrating independence from the other. The shock is justified. During and before the war, there were these extremely jingoistic and sensational articles. There were also these advertisements in newspapers by private businesses, which actually openly exploited religious sentiments, calling for jihad and depicting soldiers of a national army as Ghazi. Now that social media is in every person's hands, how far along are these posts in your scale of extremism from these ads? And there are a lot. I found these in just 10 minutes of browsing Instagram, not even Facebook or Twitter. As for Manekshaw, he was promoted to the rank of Field Marshal in 1973 and lived on a long life till 2008. Well, that was it for today. I'll meet you next time with something different. Bye for now.